Once upon a time, a goddess by the name of Eleni created the elven race using her crystal. To protect her crystal, she placed her crystal on top of her shrine with a barrier protecting it. The elves lived a peaceful life, but Eleni knew about the Twilight invasion. For the safety of her people and her princess Aluria, she created three dragons. They are Ashbite, Birisan, and Faustus. Although these dragons weren't perfect, Ashbite was still hatching, Birisan won't do a crap unless gold is paid, and Faustus' soul was linked to her crystal, meaning if the crystal fall into the wrong hands, Faustus' soul will be corrupted as well. As expected, the peace did not last forever. The invasion began under the orders of Malicia, and the first step was to kill Aluria, as Aluria is the last of Eleni's lineage. The elven race, of course, can't fight this invasion alone. They asked help from all around. They seeked attention from the Dwarven Kingdom, Lineria, and Hammerhold. Help arrived as Dinas, Vesnan, Wilbur, and Malek came for aid. But not all went according to plan, as Malek was arrested and forced to work at the Blood Quarry. The elves and our heroes did not save him just yet, as they need to stick to the plan of saving Aluria. Their journey begins at the Grey Ravens, fending off the few packs of gnolls. While they are on their journey to Aridhel, the local tree folk ask for help to defend the Great Redwood. Redwood defended, it's the capital Aridhel's turn. Save Aluria and escort her to the Griffin Point. Griffin Point at last, and now the elves must buy Aluria some time for her flight to Lineria. But this was not easy, as Malicia has rallied a massive gnoll invasion to kill Aluria from leaving Aridhel. At the end of the day, the elves were victorious and defeated Hyaena. Aluria left Aridhel and flew to Lineria for help. Meanwhile, the elves fell back into the Enchanted Forest to stop Malicia from corrupting the crystal. The elves fought with no rest, and arrived before the Unseelie Court to face Malicia. With the determination of the elves to save their queen, they won the battle. Mactan and ancient spider took Malicia away, and they retreated to the ruins of the first elven city. As the elves followed Mactan and Malicia, they got ambushed from every step they take. While on their journey to the shrine, they stumbled upon the arcane quarters, where books and the dragons were. We have Birisad and Ashbite. From there, the elves arrived at Mactan's retreat, and it was just a trap for the Twilight Elves to ambush, and it also gave time for Mactan and Malicia to arrive at the shrine before them. And here, the elves are just in time to witness the fall of their goddess and their race. Mactan and Malicia were busy destroying the barrier protecting the crystal, while the Twilight Elves buy them for more time for them. With the barrier destroyed, the crystal fell into the wrong hands. From Mactan and Malicia's greed for power, they fought on who gets it. But as they seized the crystal at the same time, it infused them into something, an abomination. Don't play with elven artifacts, kids. The last of the elven phase fought. If they don't survive, at least they had a battle to be remembered by. They did survive and defeated the spider goddess, but the price was too high. Not much of the elven race was left, but peace was indeed restored in their kingdom. The remains of the spider goddess was the corrupted crystal of Eleni. Prince Dinas and the elves discussed and decided to destroy the crystal from the flames at the Rift of Cinders. Vesnan from the shadows joined the discussion and volunteered to take care of it, but with the temptation of power, he became more evil than ever before. Vesnan left his old staff behind, and that staff will be later be used by Magnus, Vesnan's apprentice. He did not need that staff anymore, as he created a new staff, and that staff's new source of power being the crystal. Vesnan and his demons left the land and went to the Rift of Cinders, in which he built his dark tower near the rift. Meanwhile, Faustus' soul started changing. His soul got corrupted because of the crystal. Faustus turned back on his mission given by Eleni and started learning dark arts. His skin got melted away, and what remains from him are bones. He is now known as Boneheart. Remember, a dragon lives forever. As they thought it was all over, they sent messengers over to Dwarman Gates to check on them. While the messengers were on their way to the gates, there have been reports over Duskwood about Bajnimin, aka Malicia's last loyal lieutenant, is preparing a spell to avenge Malicia. The remaining elves responded and stopped Bajnimin from casting his spell all over the land. While the elves were busy celebrating over defeating Bajnimin, the elves then realized that the messengers they sent to the Dwarman gates did not return, so then investigated the gates themselves to know what was going on. The elves investigated what was going on and saw that the mines were abandoned. The elves also saw a note by the miners about a new material they have found, but they also found an ancient evil of fire and brimstone, which then led into the summoning of Godiat by mistake. They asked for help, but it was too late. The elves fended off the enemies by the gate and entered into the pit, which then they found Bulwark, the last of his kind and a lone survivor in the cave. Bulwark helped the elves defeat Godiat, and they turned out to be victorious. The elves then went back and heard news about an attack on Galardian's wall. The elves guarding that wall needed help, and so they reached to their aid. They then figured out an quarry under the beheader, slaves being tortured and forced to mine blood Sigan. One of the slaves were Malik. The elves were quick to rescue him. After saving the slaves, the elves then face off the beheader to stop his quarry activity. The elves were once again victorious. With their land clear, Tinas and Malik had to go back to their own lands. With the elves having nothing left to fight for, as Eleni has fallen, the elves together with their technology joined Tinas back to Lineria, while Malik went back to Hammerhold. The news spreaded about the fall of the goddess. With this, more evil rose across the land. One of this evil was the Winter Queen. With no one ruling the capital of Lineria, she wanted to freeze the capital. To prevent this disaster, the sorceress at the Stormcloud Temple built the Sunray Tower to imprison the Winter Queen and prevent winter. The sorcerers were able to imprison the Winter Queen, but the Sunray Tower was destroyed in the process. After this event, Lineria needed a new ruler, but the battle for the crown was not easy, as a lot of people wanted it. One of the people competing for the crown was Jack. Unfortunately for him, his head got hit by a cannonball, leaving his body at the rotted forest. And so, the title for king came to Tinas as he participated on the war between the Twilight Elves. So Tinas became the king of Lineria. As king, he made a few adjustments around the land, like transforming the Silver Oak Forest into the new home of the remaining elves. Meanwhile, on the northeast part of the map, where villagers and the legendary Blackburn lived, Blackburn fought evil for ages until eventually he became too old for it. To his honor, the villagers built a statue of Blackburn. One day, a terrible attack on the village reached the ears of Blackburn, with hundreds of villagers slain. Blackburn sought help from two sisters to shield his land from evil. Blackburn got a scroll from the ancient library and asked the sisters to perform a ritual, but this ritual had consequences. As the magic spread has been unchecked, instead of protection, corruption was the one to be spread to Blackburn's land. The remaining villagers became mindless, reanimated, flesh-hungry zombies. For the sisters, they became twisted and now thrive for the power of black magic. But Blackburn had the most tragic consequence, as his soul became corrupted and his body faded into mist. The news was then quickly to spread of Tinas being the new king of Lineria. When Vesan heard this, he quickly needed to take action to invade Lineria. He needed an army, so he made it a deal with two powerful ghosts for more power and numbers. But in return, Vesna needed to return the souls as well. The deal was made, and so the dark forces of Vesna attacked Lineria. With this army was a giant robot, also known as the Juggernaut. To defend this invasion, Tinas countered Vesna troops with the superior firepower of the Arcane Wizards and Paladins to inspire the troops with their bravery. With the efforts of the people, Lineria was defended, forcing Vesna's army to retreat at the Coldstep Mines. To ensure the safety of Lineria, Tinas requested Magnus to cast a barrier around Lineria's wall to prevent any more invasions. And so the band went to the Coldstep Mines. To accompany them were musketeers. They climbed high into the mountains until the men have reached the Stormcloud Temple. The sorceress inhabiting the temple helped open a portal to Varad Hall to face Vesna, but they do need to buy them some time as something abominable is approaching. This abominable creature was JT, but the people were able to fend off this threat, and the sorcerers were finished casting the portal. And so the band traveled deeper into the land to face off Vesnan. The troops were able to gather around and corner Vesnan at his tower. Vesnan put up a fight against Lineria's forces, but when Vesnan was on the edge of death, he transformed into something, a demon. For peace and restoration for the kingdom, Dinas' forces was able to defeat Vesnan. For Vesnan's last actions, he freed the souls he has taken. These souls were probably payment for the ancient ghosts. With our men assuming that Vesnan is defeated, reports have been saying a new orcish warlord has taken over and terrorizing the ruins of Azeroth. So some men went back and some stationed at Vesna's tower. While this discussion was happening, a mysterious figure picked up the crystal, happily saying that it is his. This mysterious figure was Lord Malagar. Malagar, together with the crystal, seemed to have vanished, well, for now. And he is currently studying a ritual and planning to steal the powerful Hammer of Ages. Meanwhile, at the ruins, the people drove the invaders away, defeating their new warlord, Boltak, in the process. Then there have been reports of a vicious band of bandits in Hushwood. The men then later found out their secret lair in the woods, with the Goldblast King being the kingpin. The efforts and bravery of the people drove the bandits away from the forest. To ensure more safety for the forest, Sir Gerald built his camp next to it. On the way back to the Dark Tower, one of the ancient spider queens has awoken and found out that the remains of Vesna's troops retreated here. But again, with the efforts of the people, they have slain Saralgas and the rest of Vesna's troops. After this, the men must travel through the glacial heights and then go back to the Dark Tower. The locals of the glacial heights reported some disturbances on top of the plateau and found out that these disturbances were caused by Ulgokhai, the troll warlord. To prevent any more disturbances, the people faced the warlord and slaying him by the end. With the snowy areas clear, the people then traveled through the rotten forest. As scouts reported, a portal to the netherworlds has opened. The people were quick to solve the root of the problem as two evil corrupted rulers of the forest seek out and spread their corruption, being Greenmuck and Minconid. The tree and the mushroom was of course defeated, and now the men must investigate on why there was a demonic portal activation in the forest. And so they carried on their journey and went back to the Dark Tower. When they went back, no one was left, except for one lone survivor. With him, our men found out that the hellish hordes rose from the depths of the Rift of Cinders, and what probably caused the portal at the forest. After defeating the first waves of demons, our men traveled deeper into hell as they faced Moloch, and it was him who caused the portals. Beside Moloch was Vesnan. Our men needed to kill this demon overlord to prevent any more portals from opening. And so they did, defeated Moloch. But as the people were busy celebrating, a demon by the name of Olok helped Vesnan escape. The help cleansed the land, the Dwarven Kingdom started deforesting the Rotten Forest, and some even redecorated Vesnan's tower into an attraction. After defeating this demon overlord, reports have said that King Banisty was on his way for the Great Tournament of Kingdoms. But on his way, he got captured and the evil is bringing him to Blackburn's castle. Unfortunately, the fastest way to the castle is through the infamous Rotwick. When they arrived at the castle, the men's hearts overflow with sadness as Blackburn fought evil for so long that it corrupted him and his land. But for King Banisty, our men had to kill Blackburn to avoid wars between kingdoms. After the events from the Dark Tower and the hellish depths of Pandemonium, Lord Malagar has been studying in an ancient library about an entity that could consume the world. He needed to perform a ritual to release this entity. To do this, Malagar needed to steal the Hammer of Ages, which is being protected in Hammerhold. And so, Malagar started his journey to steal the hammer from Hammerhold. Hammerhold stood no chance from Malagar as he has the power of the crystal. Alric requested assistance from Lyneria to retrieve the hammer. But when Alric and the forces of Lyneria returned, Hammerhold was already raided and Malagar already has the hammer. Scouts say that Malagar has traveled through Buccaneer's Den and he is on his way to the gates of Nazaru. The forces of Lyneria have to be careful as Malagar hired pirates to stop them from their tracks. But these pirates were no match from the powerful earthquakes of the Dwarf. From there, the people arrive before the gates of Nazaru. The Archmages is there to help aid in opening of the gates. But of course, this was not easy, as the genie guarding the gate fought back. But the forces of Lyneria handled this genie with ease, forcing Nazaru to go back to his lamp and the merchant offering it for sale. Then the gates shattered, which would make the men go through the Crimson Valley. After passing through the Crimson Valley, our men found a spaceship from out of this world. The necromancers around studied the spaceship and found parasites. Also, they have found a hunter by the name of Shatra. They try talking to Shatra, but they can't as Shatra speaks a language that the men can't understand. After this spacecraft disaster, the men arrive at the Temple of Sakura, which is the entrance to the caves of the Ember Spike's depths. But the savages won't give up and won't go down for a fight. When the savages did go down, the monkey guarding the temple fought back for a stand against Nineria's forces, but this monkey stood no chance, making the people advance into the mountains. While in the underpass of the caves, some men were scared as the place gives them the creeps. The guards were not scared, as the cave has easy access to gunpowder and iron. But while they were walking, some pebbles of stones were kicked. The pebble fell, alerting the Saurian lizards inhabiting the caves to fight back. Then while traveling through the caves, the men stumbled upon the lair of Birishead, a dragon very fond of gold. Birishead was probably bribed by Malagar to stop the men from their tracks. After passing by Birishead's lair, the men then stumbled upon a dwarven mining crew that dug too deep and have barricaded themselves against the Saurians. The dwarves and the men teamed up for each other's safety and mission. Then after the dark descent, the dwarves and the men went their own ways, mainly the dwarves wanting to escape and the men to stop Malagar. Speaking of Malagar, you have arrived just in time. Just in time to witness a release of a god. The Saurians bought Malagar some time to finish the ritual, and when he was done, the crystal started cracking, which then set Umbra free. Malagar was then seen hanging from the edge. He begged his master to help him, but guess what? He blasted Malagar off the cliff, and now he wants to consume the world. Now for the Kingdom of Lineria, this darkness incarnate was defeated. A massive celebration was celebrated by Lineria and Hammerhold. While they were celebrating, they forgot about the crystal. The crystal was then picked up by some random alien, never to be seen in the land again. As this crystal was passed down to Shatra, this crystal increased his health and death damage. The men were then ready to go home, but while they were exiting the cave, they found a secret passage being built by the Saurians. While they were talking, rocks fell, alerting the lizards and their king. Sizi was the name of the king, and he is ready to use his two giant mechanical hammers to smash his way through. But instead of the men getting crushed, Sizi was the one to be crushed by the powerful forces of Lineria. Then while on the way back, the men left scouts near the beach coast to take guard. They had to take guard as reports say that sailors and fishermen raised warnings about ships and people disappearing. Then the men found out that these disappearances were caused by the deep devils. Lucky enough for the men, they were near a shrine of the Lord of the Sea, making the deep devils retreat to the sunken citadel, the awakened Leviathan. Our men have to stop this sea monster, as if it attains its full power, there will be nothing in the world that can stop it. But they did stop it, making the sea crystal clear from the terrors of the deep. With the sea clear, there have been reports of an eternal night over Bonesburg. The men must hurry to aid the defenseless villagers. Apparently, the eternal night was caused by Vashal, as he awoken from his deep slumber. The sun must shine all across the land, so they did kill Vashal, but the vampirist is out to seek revenge.
Somewhere in the Rift of Cinders, Vesnon has escaped from the hellish depths of Pandemonium, and now he is looking forward to a nice bath in his Dark Tower. But to Vesnon's surprise, his Dark Tower turned into a carnival. Time to take back what is his and to start his journey to take over Lineria. Since the hideous dwarven machines have deforested his beautiful dead forest, Vesnon targeted them first. Of course, Vesnon can't take over Lineria by himself. He formed a league of villains and reformed the Dark Army that he once owned. And so, they raided the Dwarven Gates and made their way through the Kazan Mines until they eventually reached Bolger's throne. Vesnon demanded the throne and Birishead wanted the gold that Bolger owns, as Vesnon promised the gold that they will be getting from the Dwarven Kingdom. With that, the Dwarven Kingdom stood no chance and their resources are now at Vesnon's disposal. They made their way to the frozen north to face the so-called King of the North. When the Dark Army arrived at the Northerners' outpost, the Northerners had the chance to blow the horn to warn the others in the village, and that made Vesnon mad, as they now need to act faster to march down the frozen rapids and to take control of the village. When they arrived in the village, the Dark Army was able to track down the King of the North, but unfortunately, he fled via his dragon to the mountaintops. On the bright side, the King of the North is cornered on the mountain like a rat, but he won't come down for a fight. He got his horn and started blowing it to awaken Jokul. Vesnan, of course, has the tools to kill Jokul, as he has two cannons to take Jokul down, and he did, making the mountain his new real estate to view Lenaria. From the mountaintops to the ignorant farms of Otel, the pesky farmer stood no chance, making Vesnan advance into the Silver Oak outpost to capture Illyria, which he did. Then comes Magnus, Vesnan's old apprentice. The Dark Army needs to take down Magnus as he has casted a barrier around the castle of Dennis. Vesnan, of course, defeated his puny apprentice, and Magnus begged to bargain, but Vesnan begged to differ as he captured him in his shackles. With two down, one to go, Gerald seems rather calm in his camp. What a fool to think that he is the one-man army and that he can handle the Dark Army single-handedly. Overconfidence leads to Gerald's defeat. Then, the final face-off of once two great friends broke loose in the castle. Puny stone bricks will not stop Vesnan as he broke it and made Dennis retreat to the inside of the castle. Vesnan had a trick up his sleeve, and that is summoning a demon, but Dennis had a trick as well. The final battle for the kingdom between Vesnan and Dennis has come to an end. With the finishing punch of the Archdemon, Paragon stood down in defeat. Dennis locked his doors, but puny padlocks won't stop Vesnan. The padlock was destroyed by the demon, making Vesnan knock at the door. Vesnan and Dennis talked for one last time before Vesnan banished Dennis in a portal. With Dennis gone, Vesnan is the new king and ruler of the lands of Lenaria. Somewhere in the depths of the castle, Vesnan confronted a giant eye-looking thing, and from there, the true battle begins. But this true battle can't begin just yet, as Oriens have made a return to the land, and they thought that they can take what Vesnan owns. Vesnan seeked help from the Deep Devils for a chance of redemption. This redemption was made, as Pollux had no chance of survival from Vesnan's army. Then the reports say that the ancient Winter Queen broke free from her icy prison. Vesnan took action, and the Dark Army headed into the mountains to stop her, which they did. The moment then came wherein Vesnan had to fulfill his part of the bargain with the two ghosts, but Vesnan refuses to pay as the claims of the ghosts were too high. So instead of paying, Vesnan weakened the ghosts, then he locked the ghosts up for good.